everybody. Like Joel said, my name is Brian Anderson. We're from Phoenix, and my wife and I just want you to know it's such a privilege to be here at the Mid-Atlantic Regional Conference. And our conference we had a few weeks ago, it's called the Southwest Conference. And it was a really great conference, but this conference is really, really killing it. I mean, it's been amazing, and we're privileged to be here. We pastor the church called Vineyard Church of North Phoenix. There's a bunch of Vineyard churches in Phoenix, and we pastor the one called Vineyard Church North Phoenix. Hey, you know, one of the things I've really been blessed by is the worship. And I felt like the Lord spoke to me about the worship and something that we're supposed to do. You know, I've been privileged to go around to a lot of the regions in the United States over the last several years and be at conferences, and there's really something special that God is doing with the worship here in the Mid-Atlantic region and the worship leaders and the worship teams, and I think we're supposed to pray for them. Yes. And so if you're a worship team member in the Mid-Atlantic region, whether you've been on stage or not, I want you to stand up and I want you to remain standing. Now, I want all you that are around them, would you stand up and I want you to lay hands on them. We're going to pray for them. Come around to the front if they're in the front. You know, there really is something significant, I believe, that God is doing through the worship here in this region. And I pray that it spreads throughout our movement, all over the nation. And I pray that there's more. I pray that God will give us more. You know, for those of you that are newbies in the Vineyard was birthed out of worship. And we really changed the world through our worship. And what is happening across the world in worship, in part, is because of what God deposited in the Vineyard. And I believe that God wants to do a renewal of that and a new season of worship songs and worship bands and worship leaders across our movement that will again bless our world. And so for those of you that are receiving prayer, you know, just be open right now to what the Holy Spirit wants to do. Holy Spirit, would you come right now? Would you come and touch every musician, every worship leader, every songwriter? God, we're so grateful for what you've birthed in them and through them thus far. But Lord, we ask for more. We ask for your Holy Spirit to come and fall on them in such a way that you would give new songs. God, that you would wake them up in the night with new melodies and new harmonies and new songs, new lyrics, God. I pray that you would help them sort of stain their guitar behind the curtain, so to speak, and really spend that devotional time with you, Lord, so that they would be used by you as a vessel, as an instrument, to bless the church and to bless the world and to reach the lost. Lord, I pray that this group of people would represent something new that you're doing in our movement and in our world. God, especially for songs, let there be new songs that have never been released from heaven. Holy Spirit, would you begin to release those songs from heaven tonight into the hearts and minds of these men and women, and then let it spread across our land. Lord, we bless these musicians. We bless the worship leaders. We bless the songwriters. We bless you with the blessing that God has given the Vineyard from the very beginning. And Lord, we ask you to help them to run with that, to run into a new season with that, Lord. We're grateful for what you're doing, and we pray for more. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, transitioning out of that, how many of you like to exercise? Man, that went all over the map, didn't it? How many of you belong to a gym? Okay, hands down. How many of you actually go to the gym that you belong to? That's a whole different story, isn't it? Now, if you don't really like to exercise, I'm going to read you something that I think is going to make you feel a whole lot better about yourself, okay? This really has nothing to do with my message, but I like it. I thought it was kind of fun, so I'm going to read it to you. For my birthday this year, my wife purchased me a week of private lessons at the local health club. Though still in great shape from when I was on the varsity chess team in high school, I decided it was a good idea to go ahead and try it. I called and made reservations with someone named Tanya, who said she's a 26-year-old aerobics instructor and an athletic clothing model. My wife seemed very pleased with how enthusiastic I was to get started. They suggested I keep an exercise diary to chart my progress. Day one. Started the morning at 6:30 a.m. Tough to get up, but worth it when I arrived at the health club and Tanya was waiting for me. She's something of a goddess, with blonde hair and a dazzling white smile. She showed me the machines and took my pulse after 5 minutes on the treadmill. She seemed a little alarmed that it was so high, but I think just standing next to her in that outfit of hers added about 10 points. I enjoyed watching the aerobics class. Tanya was very encouraging as I did my sit-ups, though my gut was already aching a little bit from holding it in the whole time I was talking to her. This is going to be great. Day two. Took a whole pot of coffee to get me out the door, but I made it. Tanya had me lie on my back and push this heavy iron bar up into the air. And then she put weights on it, for heaven's sake. My legs were a little wobbly on the treadmill, but I made it the full mile. Her smile made it all worthwhile. My muscles all feel great. Day three. The only way I can brush my teeth is by laying the toothbrush on the counter and moving my mouth back and forth over it. I'm certain that I've developed a hernia in both pectorals. Driving was okay as long as I didn't try to steer. I parked on top of a Volkswagen. Tanya was a little impatient with me and said my screaming was bothering the other club members. The treadmill hurt my chest, so I did the stair monster. Why would anyone invent a machine to simulate an activity rendered obsolete by the invention of elevators? Tanya then told me that regular exercise would make me live longer. I can't imagine anything worse. Day four. Tanya was waiting for me with her vampire teeth in full snarl. I can't help it if I was a half an hour late. It took me that long just to tie my shoes. She wanted me to lift dumbbells. Not a chance, Tanya. The word dumb must be in there for a reason. I hid in the men's room until she sent Lars looking for me. As punishment, she made me try the rowing machine. It sank. Day five. I hate Tanya more than any human being has ever hated another human being in the history of the world. If there were any part of my body not in extreme pain, I would hit her with it. She thought it would be a good idea to work on my triceps. Well, I have news for you, Tanya. I don't have triceps. And if you don't want dents in the floor, don't hand me any barbells. I refuse to accept the responsibility of the damage. You went to SATA school. You are to blame. The treadmill flung me back into a science teacher, which hurt like crazy. Why couldn't it have been someone softer, like a music teacher or a social studies teacher? Day six, I got Tanya's message on my voicemail wondering where I am. I lacked the strength to use the television remote, so I watched 11 straight hours of the Weather Channel. Day seven, well, that's the week. Thank goodness that's over. Maybe next time my wife will give me something a little more fun, like a gift certificate for a root canal. Doesn't that make you feel better if you don't really like exercise? Well, what do you think a leader's most important battle is? Have you ever thought about that? You know, there's a lot of battles that we have as leaders. What do you think a leader's most important battle? Maybe, you know, maybe it's communicating vision to those that you're leading. Maybe it's, you know, trying to bring people who are far from God to come to know Christ. Maybe it's raising up more leaders, developing more leaders, lots of possibilities. But for me personally, I think that, you know, a leader's most important battle is the battle for our minds, the battle for our thoughts. You say, well, Brian, why do you think that? Because Satan's primary focus of attack on us as human beings is our minds. It's our thought patterns. Did you know that? See, the Bible says that demonic forces are continually trying to program our minds and program our thinking in all kinds of ways. Through the movies we watch, the television shows that we watch, the things that we see on the internet, the books that we read, the magazines that we look at. And remember, the Bible says that Satan is the god of this world. 2 Corinthians 4:4. It also says that Satan is the prince of the power of the air. Ephesians 2:2. God of this world, prince of the power of the air. Therefore, Satan is very good at doing this. He's exceptionally good at programming our minds. Well, the Apostle Paul actually addresses this whole issue in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, which we're going to look at in just a minute. But before we do that, I want you to know that this issue, winning the battle for our thoughts, is one of the major keys if you want to be able to walk in victory as a follower of Christ, and especially as a Christian leader. See, if we can gain control of our thinking through the power of the Holy Spirit, that's when we're going to be able to do what we've been singing about, walk in freedom, walk in holiness. And that's really what God wants for us. And so how do we do it? If you have a Bible, you have an electronic device, open it up to 2 Corinthians chapter 10. We're going to look really at three verses, verses 3, 4, and 5. 2 Corinthians 10, 3, 4, and 5. As you're turning there, I'd like us just to pause for a moment in prayer. We've prayed a few times tonight, but I want us to pray specifically that God would actually supernaturally speak to us out of the Scriptures. Because, you know, when we ask Him to do that, He does that. And so would you pray with me just for a moment and do your best to open your heart to Him. Holy Spirit, would you speak to every one of our hearts tonight? Speak into our minds, God, whatever we need to hear from You, we allow You, we give You freedom. Lord, say to us whatever You need to say. And Lord, I pray especially for myself. I pray, Holy Spirit, that if there are things that I've not thought about for this message or studied, but there are things that You want me to communicate, then I pray that You would drop those in my mind and heart as we go along, because we truly do want to hear from You tonight, Lord, not from me. And so as we prayed earlier, come and have Your way, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. So Paul says in 2 Corinthians 10:3, for though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh. And so Paul's saying that our, quote, warfare is not to be the same as the world's warfare. He says it's not to be fleshly. He says that we're not supposed to be like everyone else. We're followers of Jesus. And therefore, this is not our home. And yet, sadly, you've been leading, many of you have been pastoring for a long time, as I have. If you have, you know that oftentimes followers of Jesus act and respond just pretty much exactly the way the world acts and responds. We respond in fleshly ways. We respond in worldly ways, sinful ways. We even do it as pastors. We even do it as leaders. You say, what do you mean? Well, for example, what do you do when someone speaks negatively against you? Or against your church? For those of you who are pastors, what do you do when someone in your church speaks negatively against your messages or speaks negatively against your church? Some of you are having blank stares. Has not anyone ever spoken negatively about you or your church? You've only been ministering for about 3 days or something, if that's never happened to you. But what do we often do when someone does that? We oftentimes want to get back at them, don't we? We try to get even. And we so easily get involved in things, even as leaders, like gossip, like unforgiveness, like compromise, sexual sins, lying. And if we, as leaders, sometimes are getting involved in things like this. I mean, how much more those that we're leading? I mean, Christians in general, you know, our word doesn't really mean much. You know, Jesus says in Matthew 5:37, let your yes be yes and your no be no, and anything beyond that is of the evil one. Well, we can't take each other's word just because we're Christians. We break our word all the time. Christians in my church, they break their word all the time. I don't know if you guys do sign-ups in your church. We do all, you know, at least have people sign up to take classes and to volunteer, do all kinds of stuff. We just know that 50% or less of people who sign up for something will have to actually show up. That's terrible. Our word is not our bond. And so our yes isn't yes, our no isn't no. You know, as Christians, we divorce our spouses even though there's no biblical grounds. We just want out of the marriage. There's been no adultery. We just want out. You know, we take other Christians to court and we sue them. Even though Paul very plainly tells us we're not to do that in 1 Corinthians 6. And we oftentimes respond the way the world does, don't we? But God says we're not supposed to do that. We're not supposed to war like the world does, because this is not our home. The world's values are not supposed to be our values. And the truth is, God is looking for some men and women who will live with integrity. Amen. For some men and women who will live righteously, you know, in a very, very corrupt world. He's looking for people who will live godly lives. In fact, that's part of what God saved us for, so that we would be an example of godliness. You know, that's basically what Paul is saying to Titus. And in Titus 2 there, 11 to 14, he says, for the grace of God has appeared. What for? Instructing us to deny ungodliness and worldly desires and to live sensibly, righteously, godly in the present age, looking for the blessed hope and the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior Christ Jesus, looking for him to come, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from every lawless deed. And he wants to have a people who are zealous for good deeds. See, that's what we're saved for. So let me ask you, are you trying to live a godly life? I mean, that ought to be our number one goal as leaders in Christianity. Our number one goal should not be to have an amazing ministry or to be an incredible leader or have a great big church or anything like that. Our number one goal is to live a godly life. Is that your number one goal? And so the first thing Paul says is, as followers of Jesus, we're not to respond like the world responds. Though we walk in the flesh, in a flesh and blood body, we don't respond in the flesh. You say, well, Brian, how are we supposed to respond there? We're supposed to respond the way the Bible tells us to respond. Not like the culture tells us to respond, or the world, or popular opinion, or how we feel like responding. No, we're to respond like the Bible tells us to respond. And so obviously that means we need to know the Bible, doesn't it? And then Paul goes on, though we walk in the flesh, we don't war according to the flesh. Verse 4, why? For the weapons of our warfare are not of the flesh, but they're divinely powerful for the destruction of fortresses. Then he says, we're destroying speculations and every lofty thing raised up against the knowledge of God, and we're taking every thought captive to the obedience of Christ. So the good news is, God has given us lots of different weapons to battle the enemy with. But one of the greatest weapons that God has given us is to take our thoughts captive to the obedience of Christ. And that's how we, as Paul says, destroy speculation and every lofty thing raised up against the knowledge of God. Now let me unpack this a little bit for you. See, the way that Satan and demonic forces most often attack us is that they throw a thought into our mind. Paul in Ephesians 6:16 calls it a flaming missile, or other translations, a fiery dart. And that thought is intended to get us to speculate and or question some truth about God or some truth about life. And that thought comes like this. Well, if God really cared about you, this wouldn't be happening. Or this wouldn't have happened in the past. You know, whatever this is, some kind of pain in your life, some kind of difficulty, some tragedy, a heartache of some kind, sickness, a problem, the death of a loved one, whatever. And when people begin thinking this way, what we do is we start blaming God, which is exactly what the devil wants us to do. See, when some sort of difficulty comes our way and we end up blaming God for it, you know what's happening? We're getting God and life mixed up. And people do this all the time. You're all leaders. You minister to people all the time. We do it from time to time. But the people we're ministering to, they do it all the time. They get God and life mixed up. My husband just walked out of me. How could God do this to you? No. God didn't walk out on you. Your husband walked out on you. You're getting God and life mixed up. A drunk driver swerved, came across the median, killed my son. How could God let that happen to me? Wasn't God who was driving drunk? It was that man, it was that woman. They're not the one. God didn't kill your son. It's a horrible, horrible tragedy, but what's happening is you're getting God and life mixed up. How could God allow my boyfriend to abuse me and then leave me? God didn't abuse you and leave you. That was your boyfriend. You're getting God and life mixed up. My associate pastor stabbed me in the back and left with half my church. How could God do this to me? God didn't do that to you. Your associate pastor did. You're getting God and life mixed up. See, that is a key for us, is that we cannot get God and life mixed up. But the enemy is constantly throwing those kinds of thoughts into our minds. Now, the difficulty is, when that thought comes into our mind, we think it's our thought. Because it's in our mind, and therefore it must be my thought, right? And so what do we do with that thought? We start to expand on it. We start to develop it. We start to believe it. No. That thought is from the enemy. And God wants us to take that thought captive to the obedience of Christ. In other words, he wants us to switch our thinking. And he wants us instead to choose truth. He wants us to think things that are true. You say, well, what do you mean? Okay, for example, let's say you're going through some sort of a difficulty. Which we all have pain in life. Everybody has pain. It's just different kinds. And so you're going through some kind of pain, some kind of difficulty. Instead of thinking, why is God allowing this or doing this to me? I choose to dwell on the truth. I choose to dwell on scriptures like the next one, Psalm 145, verse 17. The Lord is righteous in all his ways. And he's kind in all his deeds. Doesn't always feel like he's kind. It doesn't always seem like he's kind, but I choose to believe it because it's the truth. The truth is in the scripture. The truth is not in how I feel. The truth is in the scripture. And so I choose to dwell on the truth. Or, man, I'm feeling so brokenhearted about this. You know, my church is declining, or my ministry isn't going well. My son is rebelling. This relationship is going south. I'm suffering in some way. And so what do I think about it this time? I think about the truth. Like Psalm 34, 18. You know, the Lord is near to those who are brokenhearted. That's the truth. And he saves those who are crushed in spirit. God, thank you that you are near to me when I'm feeling brokenhearted right now. I don't feel like you're near. I feel like you're a million miles away. But I choose to dwell in the truth. And the truth is that you are near to the brokenhearted. And you do save those who are crushed in spirit. So God, thank you. See, we have to continually choose the truth. When I'm going through some kind of trouble, I remember Psalm 31:7. I'm overcome with joy because of your unfailing love. Now listen to this part. For you have seen my troubles, God. And you care about the anguish of my soul. Some of you need to hear that word tonight. God not only sees your troubles, he cares. Sometimes when you're in pain, it just feels like God not only doesn't see it, but he doesn't care. But the truth is, he does. He cares about the anguish of my soul. You know, I didn't write these down. If you're taking notes, you can write them down. You all know them. Matthew 28:20, Jesus says, and lo, I am with you. How often? Always. Even to the end of the age. That's the truth. He's with us always. Whether I feel like it or not. You know, 1 Peter 5:7, you all know this one as well. Cast your cares upon the Lord. Why? Because he cares for you. That's the truth. So we have to change from thinking about our feelings to thinking about the truth. Because that's one of the major ways that Satan attacks our mind. He's trying to have us get God and life mixed up. And so we have to choose truth. Another way the devil attacks us is by planting this thought in our mind. Has God said? We all know that started with Eve in the Garden of Eden. Has God said that you can't eat from that tree? Well, God had said that. But Satan is planting doubt in Eve's mind. And he tries to do that with us all the time. For example, the way that works is, you know, the Holy Spirit is really good at convicting us of different things, isn't he? You know, John 16:8, the Holy Spirit comes to convict us of righteousness and sin and judgment. And so you're going through your day, you're in worship, you're, you know, reading the scriptures, just walking down the street, whatever, and all of a sudden this conviction comes upon you about something. Man, I have unforgiveness in my life toward this person. Or you did a shady business deal and you're starting to feel bad about it. That's the Holy Spirit convicting you. Or maybe it's more blunt. Stop sleeping with your boyfriend. Stop sleeping with your girlfriend. You know, maybe it's just something right like that. And what is the very next thought that comes? That's not that big of a deal. No big deal. Everybody does that. Has God really said that anyway? And if he did say it, it was a long time ago. Certainly doesn't mean that now. That's how it works. What are we supposed to do? Take that thought captive. Whenever you have a thought that says sin is okay, not from God. It's always from the devil. Other thoughts that the enemy plants in our mind, that doesn't apply nowadays. Sex outside of marriage, that doesn't apply nowadays. Internet porn, that doesn't apply, you know. Unforgiveness, cheating on my taxes. I mean, I can certainly use this money better than the government can use my money. You know, those kinds of things. Divorce. I don't know how many people in my church over the years have said to me something similar to, well, you know, God just wants me to be happy. And I'm not happy in this marriage. There's no biblical grounds for divorce, but I'm just not happy in this marriage. And I know God wants me to be happy. And so he said it's okay for me to get married. You know, that's what you get when you cross a crocodile with an abalone. That's a crock of baloney. That's what that is. See, the truth is, any thoughts that come into our mind that go against God or his word are not from God. And we're not to entertain those thoughts. We're to switch our thinking, take them captive. We're to use the word of God, truth, against those thoughts. Why use the word of God? Because the word of God is living, it's active, it's sharper than any two-edged sword. It pierces as far as the division of soul and spirit, of both joints and marrow. It's able to judge the thoughts and the intentions of our heart. And so, You know, someone cuts you down verbally. What do? Man, I feel like responding back in kind. I know exactly what to say. And then I remember Proverbs 15:1, a gentle answer turns away wrath. But a harsh word stirs up anger. Or I remember Ephesians 4:29, let no unwholesome word. And by the way, look at the very first word of that verse, let. That means it's a choice. Let no unwholesome word proceed from your mouth, but only such a word as is good for edification according to the need of the moment, that it may give grace to those who hear. You know, something comes on a movie I'm watching, or, you know, on Netflix, or something on the internet, or on television, and it really sort of elicits sensuality in my heart. What do? Well, I remember Job 31:1. I make a covenant with my eyes. I'm not going to gaze upon something that elicits sensuality. Gaze upon a young virgin is how it goes, but that's really the connotation. Or I remember Proverbs 4:25, let my eyes look directly ahead. Let my gaze be fixed straight in front of me. Or I remember Psalm 101, verse 3, I will set my eyes on no worthless thing. See, the bottom line, number 6 there, the Word of God is the truth. No matter what we think, no matter what we feel, the Word of God is the truth. And therefore, we must know God's Word and be committed to obey God's Word, no matter what. Let me ask you, have you made a deep commitment to God's Word? That you're going to obey God's Word no matter what? You know, the way that we talk about that in our church is, are you a chocolate milk Christian or are you grapefruit? Now, the way that we unpack that is, you all know a grapefruit, when you take a grapefruit and you cut it in half and it has all those little sections in it. Know what I'm talking about? You guys have a blank stare. Just pretend like you're paying attention. Like this. Okay. Yeah, it has all those little sections in it. And that's how lots of followers of Jesus think they can follow Jesus. Give him a few sections. Well, I'll allow Jesus to, you know, call the shots in my finances, but not in my sexuality. That's mine. This section's mine. I'll allow Jesus to call the shots in my relationships, but not on my finances. I'll allow Jesus to call the shots in my marriage, but certainly not in my free time. That's grapefruit. That's not the real deal. The real deal is chocolate milk. You know, you ever make chocolate milk? Pour a glass of milk, and then you put in the Hershey's or the you know, whatever it is, the Nestle's, or Quick, or whatever, and you stir it all up. Is there like some of the milk that's still regular milk and the rest is chocolate? Or is it all chocolate? It's all chocolate. Jesus is the chocolate. He wants to affect every area of our life. Where he calls the shots in every single area. In our finances, in our sexuality, in our language, in the things that we watch, in the way that we spend our free time, in our energy, in our money, every area. Are you chocolate milk? God wants us to be chocolate milk. Another major way the enemy attacks there, letter C, is he uses thoughts of accusation and condemnation against us. That ever happened to you? I'm not going to read Revelation 12:10, but the last part says, he's the one who accuses us before God day and night. He's an accuser, isn't he? He accuses us all the time. And what do those attacks go like? You call yourself a Christian and you did that. First of all, he's telling you to do it. It's okay, no big deal. And then when you do it, you call yourself a follower of Jesus and you did that. You're like the worst Christian in the history of the world. You are the worst pastor ever. You're the worst leader in this entire planet. Nobody cares about you. God doesn't love you. Your heart is so evil. If people knew how evil your heart was, nobody would be following you. What do you do with those thoughts? You take those thoughts captive. Why? Because they're not the truth. You say, well, Brian, how do you know they're not the truth? Okay. Let's say you are the worst Christian in the history of the world. or the worst pastor? Somebody has to be. Maybe it's you. I don't know. So let's say it is you. So what if it's you? So what? Because the truth is, 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, God is faithful and righteous to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. The truth is, the next scripture there, what did I write? Romans 8:1, there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. The truth is, 2 Corinthians 5:21, God made Jesus who knew no sin to be sin on my behalf, our behalf. Why? So that we might become the righteousness of God in him. That's the truth about you. Not those other lies that the enemy's throwing at you. So you take them captive. They're not true. And you need to fight against those thoughts by taking them captive. Now you say, well, Brian, why is this so important? Because if the enemy can gain control of our thought life, he controls us. He can't stop us from maybe going to heaven one day, but we're going to be totally ineffective. See, the good news is God wants our minds to be renewed. He really does. He wants us just to cooperate with him, and he'll renew our minds. That's really what Paul's saying there in Romans 12:2. You know, it says, and do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed, how? By the renewing of your mind. Why? So that you may prove what the will of God is, that which is good and acceptable and perfect. So how is our mind renewed? I'm just going to give you two quick ways, or more ways than this, but just two. One way, and a major way, is by washing our mind on a regular basis with God's word. Washing our mind with God's word. Ephesians 5:26, so that he, Jesus, might sanctify her, the church, followers of Christ, us. How? Having cleansed her by the washing of the water of the word. Did you know God's word renews your mind? And you're transformed by the renewing of your mind. And so again, that means we need to read God's word. We need to study God's word. We need to memorize parts of God's word. We need to meditate on God's word, especially, you know, as pastors and leaders. Paul says, let the word of Christ richly dwell within you with all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another with psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with thankfulness in your hearts to God. You know, Colossians 3:16, Psalm 119:97, oh, how I love your law, your word. Oh, how I love your law. I meditate on it day and night, the psalmist says. Joshua 1:8, this book of the law, meaning your word, this book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate on it day and night. You shall meditate on it. Why? So that you may be careful to do according to all that is written in it. And then you will make your way prosperous, and then you'll have success. Psalm 1:1-3, how blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, nor stand in the path of sinners, nor sit in the seat of scoffers, but who delights, he is the one who delights in the law of the Lord. In his law he meditates day and night. And here's what will happen. He'll be like a tree firmly planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in its season, and its leaf does not wither. And in everything he does, he prospers. Man, we have to be a movement that reads God's word, meditates on God's word, memorizes God's word. And if in your past, or even currently maybe for some of you, if you've ever been involved with drug addiction, like I was, or you were ever involved in, you know, heavy pornography, sexual immorality, lust, greed, fear, if you're involved in the occult, involved in different cults, maybe JWs or Mormons or whatever, I have good news for you. Those things can be totally healed by the washing of the water of the word. I know that from firsthand experience. I do. I mean, before I came to Christ, I had a drug habit. I was kind of like Andy was talking about all the time. I was stoned all the time. And I know it doesn't happen all the time because I've been in ministry a long time. But the way it happened for me, I had an encounter with Jesus one night, my senior year in college. I was 22 years old. I got down in my room after smoking a big bong hit, coughing like crazy, and knowing I have no way, nowhere else to go. I'd heard about Jesus, did not grow up in the church, and really didn't know hardly anything, but just knew the name. I got down on my knees and I said, "Jesus, if you're real, I can't live like this." And I was instantly delivered. I never touched another drug. And I know it does not happen like that usually, but that's the way it happened with me. But even though now I was a father, by the way, that was when I was 22. That was like 10 years ago now, something like that. That was way too big of a laugh. Anyway, so even though I was delivered, my mind was messed up. I couldn't remember things. I got married to Thor not too long after that, and she'll attest, I lost things all the time. You know what I started doing? Started memorizing lots of scripture. Just memorizing, reading. God began to heal my mind, began to heal my memory. And now I tell my kids, my mind is like a steel trap. And it's not true, but I tell them that. Same with my language. You know, I was an athlete growing up, and I was always kind of not the most talented person, but I got the most out of it. And so I always used my mouth as leverage, as try to get into people's brains, you know, into their heads. And I used foul language all the time. I didn't know any adjectives. Seriously, Thor will attest to that. I had no adjectives that were not a four-letter word. I cussed all the time. And as you can probably know, if you were saved as an adult, when you get saved out of something, your spirit is saved, but there's a lot of other parts of you that are not, they have not come along yet, right? And my language was one of them. I mean, I cussed all the time. And so I didn't want to do that. I hated it, but it was ingrained. You know what I did? I think I memorized just about every verse in the Bible about the mouth, the tongue, my language. Swear to God, I never even think about cuss words anymore. They don't ever enter my mind. It's weird. I don't let my kids give me a hard time. They're 12 and 13. I don't let them say B-U-T-T. They're like, oh, come on. Everybody's saying it. I don't let them say it because I don't want them to get hooked into what I got hooked into. So if you've ever had anything like that, there's hope. The Word, man. The Word. So the second way that our mind is renewed, besides washing it by God's Word, is by making decisions in your life that are based on God's Word and not based on your feelings. See, every time you do that, your mind gets renewed. Say, what do you mean? For example, somebody, again, wrongs you in some way. This is so prevalent in the church, isn't it? Hurts you in some way, speaks against you. You have a choice. I can respond back to them the way I feel like responding, the way the culture tells me to respond. Or I can respond like God's Word says to respond. Remember the Lord's Prayer? Forgive me my trespasses as I what? Forgive those who've trespassed against me. I make a choice. I'm going to forgive them. I'm going to choose to forgive. Every time you make a choice based on God's Word and not your feelings, your mind gets renewed. Or you tell somebody that you're going to help them move. They're in your small group. They're going to move on Saturday. You're going to tell them, you're going to help them move on Saturday. And then all of a sudden something better comes along. You know that one? You get tickets to the Carolina Panthers game. You know, or Virginia Tech, or I don't know who the teams are really here. I just know I don't like the Carolina Panthers because they beat my Cardinals last year in the NFC Championship game. But I am bummed about it, but I don't dislike them. So what do you do? Man, I got these tickets to the Washington Nationals or the Cardinals or whatever, but I gave my word. What are you going to do? Going to sell the tickets. There you go. Is your yes going to be yes? And your no going to be no? You know, there's a scripture, you can write it down. It's a great Psalm 15. That whole psalm, it's only 5 verses. It's all about being a person of integrity. It's a great chapter to memorize. But verse 4, Psalm 15, 4, talking about a person of integrity, he swears to his own hurt and does not change. Meaning you've given your word about something, but man, to keep my word's going to hurt. But I don't change. Every time you make a decision like that, your mind gets renewed. See, when we choose according to God's word, man, this renewing happens. What I'm saying, number one, as you choose truth, God supernaturally renews your mind. And so if we're ever going to walk in victory as followers of Jesus, man, we have to control our minds through the power of the Spirit. And the bad news is, there are no shortcuts to this. It takes hard work. You know, there's no downtime for your mind. As a follower of Jesus, you can't just say, okay, I'm just going to veg out. I'm not going to worry about taking thoughts captive. I'm just going to watch this thing. And, you know, if I fantasize a little bit or lust a little bit, no big deal. No. That 2 or 3 minute fantasy that you allowed your mind to go on, that's going to set you back weeks, months, maybe even years in your battle against lust. You can't do that. Your mind never gets to go on vacation as a follower of Jesus. And so I want to challenge you, commit to God's word, to study it, to meditate on it, to memorize parts of it. And why is it so important, that last thing? Because God's word is our greatest weapon over demonic thoughts fired into our minds. Let me leave you with this. The next 10 years are going to go by. They're going to go by quickly. You young people, you don't realize. 10 years goes by like that. Now listen to this. I'm speaking to every one of you personally. The next 10 years are going to go by. Are you going to have 10 years of being in the Word every day? Or are you going to be exactly where you are right now? It's your choice. Let's pray. Holy Spirit, come. I know many of you are making commitments right now to the Word. And I want you to know that blesses God. And some of you are feeling beaten up by, well, I haven't been good at that. I just haven't been disciplined enough or whatever. First of all, there's no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Lord, I pray in the name of Jesus that you would break the power of every demonic thought of condemnation that's coming upon my brothers and sisters. I break it off in the name of Jesus. I say no to it. And I pray, Lord, that you would release hope into every heart, that we really can become men and women of the Word. I break the lie that has told some of you that you're not smart enough, that you just can't remember it enough, that you're not good at it. I curse that lie in the name of Jesus. I say, stop it right now in the name of Jesus. And Lord, bring freedom. Bring new hope. Bring new freedom, new abilities, God, to read your word on a regular basis. And Lord, I pray right now that you'd begin to release plans all across this room, plans on when am I to do that. You know, it's different for every person. For me, it's always been first thing in the morning. That may not work for you, but you need to find a regular time where you can be in the Word. Lord, I pray you'd release plans right now that are from you, where people will carve out time in their schedule and begin to really be men and women of the Word. You know, I know there are impartations that happen in certain areas of spirituality. And for whatever reason, God has really helped me in this whole thing of scripture and taking thoughts captive. And I think God wants me to impart whatever God has given me in this to you, to many of you at least. There are some of you that are just like, there's something, you're just yearning for more of that. And I want to pray for you. I want to pray that there'd be an impartation. So if that's you, if this is like, man, I want to be better at this. I'm really making a deep commitment. I mean, we all want to, you know, be men and women of the word and so forth. But if this is something you're like, this is really for me, you know that God is speaking to you, then I want to pray for you, a special prayer. Would you just stand right where you are? This is you. Just stand up. Now, I just want you to open your heart. You don't have to do anything. You don't have to strive. Just receive. Just receive. Just maybe close your eyes, block out. You don't have to close your eyes, but that helps me as you block out distractions. This is between you and the Lord. Lord, I pray that for my brothers and sisters that are standing, God, thank you for the deep yearning that you've given them for more of the word. And I pray, Lord, whatever grace that you've given me in that, whatever ability, whatever anointing, I pray tonight, Lord, that there would be a holy impartation for greater hunger for your word, greater understanding of your word, greater discipline in your word. Lord, let there be a holy impartation to my brothers and sisters. And I pray especially for memorization. Some of you have been lied to by the enemy, and the enemy has told you over and over, you just don't have the brain to memorize. I curse that lie in the name of Jesus. Lord, I pray that you would release new ability and new anointing to memorize scripture so that we can take thoughts captive throughout the day and we can begin to think about truth and not about the lies that the enemy is throwing into our minds. Lord, release memorization ability, desire, all of that. And then I feel like the Lord really wants to impart greater fire and anointing in preaching and teaching in some of your lives. Especially those of you that are teaching on a regular basis, a small group, a church, you teach on a regular basis. I would love to have some of us lay hands on you and really ask for the fire of God to hit your mouths, to hit your throats, and that God would begin to anoint your words even more powerfully than he's done in the past. And so if you teach or preach on a regular basis and you'd like to be prayed for about that, would you just come up to the front right now? First of all, I want to say what you do in teaching and preaching God's word is so important. It is so important. The word of God, that's the thing that changes lives. The word of God changes people's lives. And God wants to anoint you in greater ways than he's anointed you in the past. But like I said earlier, the other side of that is you have to work. Man, this isn't just, you know, all fuzzy and, you know, God anoints me and that's it. And then I don't have to study anymore. I don't have to really get into the scriptures and so forth. Andy talked about that last night. I so appreciated what he had to say about that. We have to dig in. I mean, there's a lot of hard work, but we need anointing. And I believe God wants to anoint us in a greater measure.